Hi Pawan, welcome to Film Companion South. Good to finally have you here.
Glad to be chatting with you, and very happy to be on the forum.
I just love this mural behind you. Just tell me what it is. It's like this amazing background.
So I'm not sure if you've heard of Badal Nanjunswamy. He became quite popular in the last couple of years for doing street art. So he's picked up a lot of problems in the city, and he goes and creates an art around it, and it gets the attention of the officials, and they quickly fix it. So
Okay.
I have known him since my first movie, that's 2011,
Life
and
is
he's
Strange.
the Life of Shtene. Yeah, so he's an artist. So when I set this office up, there was this empty wall. So I told him, and I said, this was right after Lucia. So I called him and I said, this wall is yours, you can do whatever you want. So he spent like 4 days, and he came up with this whole, basically to say what happens in my head or something. And that's Alfred Hitchcock. And
This is all
so
in your head. This is Pawan
no,
Kumar.
that's his interpretation. And then my wife came and made sure he does
Okay.
that. So she
Because you're a mobile user on the throne.
that's where my ideas come in from.
You see, most of us outside of the Kannada film industry, who live in other cities and who have started getting Kannada films only fairly recently, with subtitles and all that. Of course, I'm ignoring the pandemic period. Most of you know you from Lucia, as the guy who pretty much revolutionized everything in Kannada cinema by making this independent movie that just blew everybody's mind. But before that, you made Life of Ishtene. What is your sensibility? I mean, in other words, interpret that mural for us. It's like, what is Pawan Kumar's head and sensibility like? What subjects are you drawn towards? What movies are you drawn towards?
People think that I know too much cinema, or I watch too much, and all that, but it's actually not true. So I started off with theater, and what had fascinated me in theater is that it is a thought, and it is wrapped with a lot of layers. And as an audience, you get to peel out these layers and slowly go to the deeper meaning and understand what the storyteller is saying. So I think right from my theater days, that is what fascinated me as a viewer and as a storyteller. So even my theater works used to be similar, wherein I don't, spoon feed or just say something directly. I would like it to be open to interpretation. Like I try to put my thought out, which will have ways of looking at it differently. And people can discuss about it and understand it in their own way. So I've always felt that I was drawn to that kind of cinema as well. I was drawn to films that were also extremely moving,
Okay.
emotionally moving. And like my early cinema, like when I was not really, I hadn't seen any world cinema till I saw Life is Beautiful.
Okay.
So that was the first film that I saw on big screen with subtitles, and I'm like, wow. So I mean, we were also told when we were growing up, the subtitle movies are boring films.
Yeah.
So I never was with a gang of friends or anyone who watched that kind of film. So for me, when I saw that, it really moved me, and then I started looking at more things. And some of the first few films that really influenced me strongly were the well-made popular genre films like Schindler's List,
Right.
Fight Club, Philadelphia. So I became an instant fan of Tom Hanks and his films, and also Spielberg and his films. So then I also was a big Jim Carrey fan. So it was like a mix of these things, So in the early days, when we used to have those 14-inch monitors with a normal desktop computer, I used to try and watch these many times. And somehow I felt I was drawn to the way they told stories.
Right.
And I would say that's all I know. And I like to write my stories like this mural, because you use that example. The way Badal made it is that if you keep staring at it, you will keep looking at different elements.
Right.
They're all hidden. There is something, some lens lying somewhere, and there's a film reel lying somewhere. And I like the fact that you spend time with the work, and then you draw more things out of it.
So I mean, you could keep staring at that mural for several hours and come up with several things. So
Thanks, yeah.
the idea is that you can keep looking at a Pawan Kumar movie and keep coming up with different things, kind of.
I hope that
Oh,
happens though.
okay.
I mean, while I make it, that's the intention. There are layers that I see when I shoot a scene or when I write and shoot a scene. There is always the surface layer, which probably people very easily get. But there'll be those little things that I try because I find joy in doing it. And when people have come up to me and spoken about those one or two things, it makes me really happy.
So in a film like Lucia, for instance, the very fact that it has layers is very apparent because the movie itself is structured in a very, like, almost like a surreal manner, you know, where people switch places or there's a dreamlike kind of narrative to it. But let's take something like U-Turn, right, which is a more, to use your word, popular genre. There is a surface layer that is pretty easy to kind of follow and get involved in. Give me a scene in that you have added a sub layer, just to get an example of what you mean.
For example, somebody actually pointed it out and reminded me, and which is when I, so there is this conversation between the protagonist Rachana and her guy. And the first time she goes and sits in front of him, and she says, "Are you busy?" He says, "No, the regular, you know, theft, robbery, rape, and all that." So somebody said that they found that how I put the word rape in a casual way that he says it. Now, if you look at it, it's not that I planned it and put it, but my subconscious has always felt that rape has been brought down to such, like, every day you're constantly hearing that it's happening so much that somewhere we have all become a little numb to that action, right? We read it somewhere, we're like, huh, okay, so it happened there. It's not any more shocking. So I would say that in a film like U-Turn, a character who just says this line is a little bit of me somewhere who's like my thought, my projection of what I feel it has become. So that's the thing that comes to my mind right now. Probably the dream sequence where she wakes up on the flyover. You know, those are the things where I would say, because I come from theater, and in theater you do a lot of these things. And if you see any of my films, like Ujjane onwards, or even the ones which I tried as an assistant with Yogaraj, I've loved to bring in that surreal element into storytelling. You know, that where I feel I connect to every individual. Because when you tell, like U-Turn, fairly, it was a very surface, straight story told with a certain emotion and a thought. But when you create a dream layer like that, I feel everybody has something going on in their minds.
It becomes more than just the story.
So I feel I connect to them at such a level.
So tell me, when you like to challenge yourself and your viewers like this, what joy do you get out of directing a U-Turn in Telugu and Tamil, in the sense that what challenges do you I mean, of course, it could have been a financial decision, but I'm saying, is there something more, in the sense of, like, because you've already made it once and you're making it twice, do you try to do little tweaks, do you try to, like, how do you make it fun for yourself? Because, you know, a lot of directors say that you know, once a script is written and once everything is there, you have to really keep trying to make things fun for you, because on the sets, otherwise you're pretty much, it's just an execution job. Like, you just have, you're basically, you've written all the good stuff. Now you're just basically staging it. So you don't have to try to make it more and more interesting for you by trying, like, to stage it really well. How does, like how do remakes happen with you?
It's happened only once, and also tried it because I wanted to see what it feels like. There were 2-3 reasons why I jumped at it. One, when I made U-Turn, it was a self-produced film and I had a huge financial restriction. Shot it in 27 days, and it was like, I mean, you know, there were so many things which I wrote differently and I couldn't shoot it because we didn't have money for it. So that happened. And then Samantha saw the trailer and she called up, and so then she came and helped me promote the film a little. And the reason when the lights were picked up, I told them that only if Samantha is doing will I come forward, because I just somewhere felt that I had to, you know, return something to her because she was so keen on doing the show. That was one.
Right.
Two, I was also very keen on, I'd heard people say this, you know, how can you redo the whole thing? See, but I also come again, I mean, I think I've said it 4 times already, that I come from theater where we do a show, but it's never over there.
Right,
you go back and keep doing. Like, there is a play which I've done some 40 times already in over last 15 years. So what is the difference between the show that I put up in 2002 to the show that I put up in 2018 is that with me, my performance has evolved, with me, the way I render the line is evolved. So I wanted to see, will that happen in cinema as well? So I just, you know, I took it up as an experience, and it did feel like that. It never felt stale, because I was dealing with a completely set of, nobody from this team had come into that. Right. I was the only one who went in. Right. So I was dealing with a different set of technicians, different camera, different budget. And U-Turn is fun to make in the sense, because see, nobody gave me 80 days to make it. You know, it's just because it's Samantha and the budgets are a bit higher, but I still had to make it in 45 days, two languages. And shooting on the flyover and all, though, I don't know how many love it or how many don't love it, but as it gives you a high when you crack that part, because you're shooting in live locations and you've got to see direction, creative. I'm sure many directors have told you this is probably 20-25%, because most of it is done in writing and planning. The rest 75% is how you handle the set. And that's a high when you get the entire crew to work in your way. So that's what. And in terms of adaptation, I'm not sure if you saw the Telugu Tamil one. The last 20 minutes was rewritten.
Yeah.
It was made a bit differently from the Kannada one. Of course, there are people who like the Kannada one more. I mean, that conversation has always happened. There are people who like the Telugu one. So I like the fact that there are people who talk about it. As a writer, that's what
you want. You know, you're a director, known as a director. You've also produced films. You've also written films. Which job excites you the most? Which gives you the most satisfaction?
Till about I did Kudi Edumaithe, I had never really, really directed someone else's work.
Right.
I had done Laila, two episodes, which was heavily written by many people and all that. That was the, in fact, I also took it up at that point because I loved the theme that Laila was set in and all that. And also wanted to see how, as a director, now I handle someone's script. So that's why I jumped in. But with Kudi, again, I did do a lot of adaptations to it. So I would say that I think equally, because I just finished writing the Dvitva shooting script and I enjoyed the process of writing. So how it works with me is when I write, I'm literally going through the emotions which the characters are. So when I'm doing the emotional scenes, I'm literally actually crying. I'm too sensitive a person. It happens. So I'll be typing and I'll be like pouring out. And then I wipe and then go out. So when I'm directing it, I try to now feel that through somebody else, through the actors. And I would say that not many times has that been met, you know, because I go through it so intensely. Writing is just me. There's no one else, right? So you get a high because you're pushing your boundaries and what you can do. But as soon as you're shooting, you are basically collaborating with 100 people and trying to reach your vision.
Right.
So, and it's very, many a times you will not be able to get there, you know? And I think directing is where you understand this truth. And then you make that part fun, that you know that what you saw in your head is not really going to happen, but yet you enjoy that. Yeah.
You spoke of Kudi Edamaithe, and before that you did Laila a couple of episodes as well. Do you find the OTT space a happy space to be in?
Depends on who's running the show.
Okay.
You know, it has its, I think the space offers itself amazing platform, like to do as a writer. I was telling that when I was writing Dvitva, I had to constantly tell myself that I can't go beyond 130, 140 pages. You know, like for me, I knew that the scene has so much more conversation to happen, but there is an upper limit to it. But when you do series, you know, you have a free flow. If you're enjoying something and it's going on, the characters are exposing themselves to so much more drama, then you can always put in another episode. So that way, as a writer, it's a great thing to be writing series. It's also very challenging. Unlike movies, I would say after doing two series, movies are far more easier to make than a series. In series, because you're going to so many layers. If a series works with the audience, then it's like, it's an amazing experience.
Yeah, and that's exactly what I was going to ask you, like, what is the difference? Because technically the process is the same. You write a script, you shoot the script, and then you put it out there. So there's no real difference in the overall the process itself. Mm-hmm. But what makes it so different to get into the series space than like a movie space? Is it just the writing part, or even the directing is a little different?
And I think if we have to keep the budgets we get in mind, get to do a series, at least in India right now, or at least the ones I got, you would get probably 1/4 the movie budget, but you have to do twice the length. You know, so I would, because a movie is 2 hours. Right? Like, right. For example, Pudiyadimaita is like 4+ hours.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I had to shoot it in 45 days, wherein there are films where people shoot for 150 days, and or I have shot, like Lucia was 45 days. So I've shot 2 hours in 45 days, and I had to shoot 4 hours in 45 days. So because that's the budget we were given to make the show in. So in terms of directing, it's a challenge. You're trying to squeeze in a lot more and do much. But in terms of writing, the joy is, like I said, you get to explore the character so much more. You know, in films, you will not really get that time because of that 2.5 hours gap.
No, I really liked how elegant the staging was in Kudiyadamaithai. Like I still remember a scene. I think this is episode, I'm not sure whether it's 1 or 2, but two girls come to see the Amalapal character. Did you tell her not to wear any makeup? Did you not want her to wear any makeup at all? Was that her decision?
She's actually someone very brave. Like, you know, when I told her the character is something like that, she would say, then I will not do it. I will tie my hair in her. So she would come up with those. I was initially I wanted to ask for these things, but I was wondering, will she be okay with it? But in that little, sat in her room and we were discussing, and she came up with these, I want to then I said, okay, then let's push it all.
Yeah. So these two girls come to see her, and then you can sense that they're a little hesitant to talk in front of this male, subordinate of the Amalapal character. Yeah. So she says, go get me some coffee. And you do something very interesting. Like, normally people would just cut to like that man leaving, and then this conversation happened. But then you keep the people there. The man, the camera follows the man. He comes out and does a U-turn there. Hey, U-turn. So the command comes out, does a U-turn there, and stands like there's a glass wall separating where he's there and where Amalapal and the two girls are there. And then the camera just looks up a little bit and sees the expression on her face. And I was like, wow, okay. So that's kind of when I realized, okay, this is not some... I mean, I know your film, so like I know that you like to stage your scenes, but I was like, wow, doing that in an OTT space with all these constrictions must have been like so you still really thought out your scenes.
So in fact, that shot, I'll tell you the little story because you picked the right shot to discuss about. So in the original script which Ram Vignesh wrote, so the scene actually plays out. The scene plays out wherein these girls tell her that, listen, I'm pregnant and all that stuff. Now, my question was that if you say it right there in the second episode, the actual way of what happened is revealed later in the third episode. So I said, audience will find it a repeat. You know, if you reveal that in the second and then show her flashback in the third, then the whole of third chunk is not required.
Right.
So my question as a writer was, we should not give this information away. You know, they should come, say something, but audience shouldn't hear it.
Yeah.
Now, the thing is, now either you cut to another timeline and come back, but we don't have another timeline. We were on Durga's track. So that's when I put in the, because I always knew this constable character was there, Murthy. So I said, if we follow Murthy's point of view, you know, you get out and with him gets out the audience. So as soon as that thought came in, that was, you know, fixed. And then we went to the police station set. We put those bars. So I rehearsed the shot way before. I told my DOP Advaita that we'll come out with him. We'll come and make him go from his point of view, that how he wants to hear, but he's not getting to hear it. So the audience feel like, shit, what did we miss out?
Very, very nicely done, Pawan. That was like a for an OTT. When I say for an OTT series, for some reason, Hindi OTT series have leapt leaps and bounds ahead in terms of, because they've also started much earlier. So I think they've figured out a lot of things. Whereas in the South, it's very difficult to find, there are interesting concepts and all, but it's very difficult to find well-made OTT series, you know? And I think you really cracked this with the thing. Despite, I had a few issues with it, but overall, it was a very elegantly made series. And I really thought, doing that for the OTT was a great start for thing. Why Telugu though?
No, the script came to me from AHA.
Oh, okay.
So it was AHA said, we have a script and would you want to direct it?
Did you have any language issues? You know Telugu?
No, because I grew up, my mother is from Andhra.
Oh,
so
okay,
so I grew up hearing a lot of Telugu.
So it was not a problem.
It's a little easier, yeah.
Next film is a big, big film. Like it has Puneet Rajkumar, it has Trisha, it's called Dvitva. You said you just finished writing it and you went through all the emotions with it. So let me ask you is Pawan Kumar moving away from the independent space to a more mainstream space? And I don't mean this as a bad thing because the thing is everyone wants their films to be seen. And as somebody in Chennai, I've seen how much Tamil filmmakers who are making independent films struggle to kind of, you know, make their film seen. And so when they get the opportunity to work with a star, they are willing to do certain things that they would not have done otherwise, simply because they think, okay, let's at least do a couple of these and then kind of do that. So I hope that didn't sound like insulting to you, but I just wanted to know, what is the thing in your head that made you say, this is the star cast that I want for this movie?
I think, like you said, with the OTT space coming in and with everybody watching world content, it's that the stars have also seen that their own audience are now watching world content. See, when there was that single screen, theatrical business, and who comes in the first 3 days, are the fans coming in and do they like a certain kind of films? All those are dictated heavily by the business and how the business dictated the script later. But I have met Puneet Rajkumar sir since 2008 or something when I was assisting Yog Rajpal. And every time I met him, he used to talk about so much more of world cinema, and he is a big fan of Tom Hanks. And he used to talk about some of Tom Hanks' film and say how he liked some of those scenes. And I was fascinated because, you know, till I didn't meet him, I thought, okay, this commercial films that we see is what he makes. But when I met him, there was this whole other knowledge that he would also bring in, that what his father used to tell
him. Yeah, many people have told me this. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so it was, so I instantly fell in love with the fact that he appreciates all this kind of work. So since then, I thought, okay, someday we should collaborate. And like I've mentioned earlier, he has seen my work. He would call up when he's seen a Lucia or when he's seen a U-turn. He made a YouTube video and put it up. So he's very appreciative of the work that I've done. So when I wrote Dvitva, when I wrote the first draft, which was in 2019, I sent him a copy just to get a feedback. You know, I said, like, it would be great if you read it and say, I already generally send my scripts to a couple of people I know and I want to hear their opinions. And he read and he said, it'd be great to make it. And, you know, it would be, and he immediately showed that interest. I said, if you want to make it, then amazing, because it fits into the age group and the character and the way it is. The kind of films that he likes. And when I met Hombale and then when we all spoke, all that they've told me till now was, do your film.
Right.
You know, do the film the way you do. And this is the budget and these are the actors. And you will get what you want. So thankfully, I would say I haven't moved into a stream where I'm changing how I view something. But I'm getting all these people to come and be part of the vision that I sort of had.
Maybe ask a reverse question. If Lucia had been made today, do you think it would have worked to a larger extent in the OTT space?
In the OTT space, as a film, yeah. Definitely. Definitely, okay. It would have gotten a lot more audience. It would have reached. I think why Lucia, Life Waits Tene would have done much better. So I'm sure you haven't seen Life Waits. It's a very
that's what I'm saying. See, Lucia is the one film that somehow slipped through the cracks and came to other states. The others didn't. So
Life Waits Tene was a very. It was basically the storyline of how Premium was. It's just that I made it in 2011. And I think there are many similar genre films. I think My Autograph had that sort of a feel. So for me, the first film, it had to be a safer film, popular genre. It had 2 songs shot in Ladakh and all that. But somehow there are some people I meet who say that that's a better film than a Lucia or a U-turn or anything. You know, so, but I still tried those things. I tried whatever my theater influences were. If you were to see Lucia today, you will see that it's not a typical rom-com. It had those little deviants which would make you feel like, or hints which then became Lucia's later. That if Life Waits Tene was there today, it would have worked very well because of those new ideas that were used in tele. For example, the camera, we shot it on a 16mm and we used only zoom lens, which is usually used in an action film. You know, for a rom-com, you use a block lens and you have very beautiful frames. But I said, let's treat a rom-com like a fast-paced film. So the entire film was handled with the zoom constantly happening. And we never used any
lens. You kept zooming in and out.
Yeah, in and out. Like how a Hurt Locker was done. So, and I said, let's break this and let's see how it happens. Thankfully, I had a producer who was okay with it. I had a DOP who initially didn't like it, but later he loved the format. And the whole film, he was on a 16mm doing that. So Digant was the leading actor in it. So when he's saying something emotional, and the camera is moving in and out, and there are sudden pans. So I had great fun doing it that way. But that's the last time I used Zoom in my life. After that, I liked the traditional format.
You've never used a Zoom lens after that?
After that, never. I don't even get it on myself now. I just don't like the glossy feel it creates.
And finally, Pawan, do you think Kannada cinema is finally having its moment, in the sense that, you know, Malayalam cinema is currently having a glorious run of movies, and it's like really having a moment right now. There are films in Tamil and Telugu that are happening that are like whether you look at a Bahubali, in its own way, it's creating a sensation. Do you think that is finally happening in Kannada cinema, where on the one hand you have a KGF 2 that is most hotly anticipated, you know, multiple languages and kind of things? On the other hand, you have all this happening. You're the Puneet Rajkumar kind of star coming and, working in this kind of a space. Do you think that moment?
It is definitely a beginning. We hope that the responses also lead to more. Like how they say Lucia was sort of starting point. I don't take credit for it. I mean, I'm glad that I was part of it. So it kicked off many filmmakers to make certain things. I hope with Vitva and with Puneet Rajkumar and Trisha and everyone being part of it, then leads like many more high concept, big budget films. Yeah.
Right. So that's all you're going to give us about Vitva, that it's a high concept, big budget film?
What else do I tell you?
No, I won't trouble you. So thanks so much, Pawan. It's been a pleasure talking to you. And really, I look forward to this film, because it's always interesting to me when a filmmaker with a very strong sensibility gets into bed, so to speak, with stars, because there are, they come from a different space usually, not necessarily because of who they are in personal life, but because how they've been projected in the films. So that's always a very interesting mix. And I look forward to Ditwa. Please make sure that it reaches all of us. And yes, thanks again.
Thank you so much.
I'm going to, after this, ask you to send me if you have a copy of Life Wish Day.
I will. But all warnings that you have to see it as a 2011 first film popular genre.
I'm fairly sure that I will somehow find a, use that mural behind it, do a freeze frame and try to unscramble it for myself. So
please, yeah.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.